about this one?
Three school, and the first of a number of fora on the stormwater, proposed stormwater ordinance and utility for Northampton. I'm Councilor Owen Freeman Daniels, Ward 3, and I wanted to briefly lay out the format of what we were trying to get accomplished today, or at least what we're trying to present today, and introduce some of the main figures that might be talking heads. I'm available to answer political-type questions, or process-type questions about where this proposed ordinance is in the pipeline, and can render my opinion about the potential for the council and amendments and so on and so forth. But it's very unlikely that I will be voting on this ordinance. I'm retiring from public service, and so I can certainly give you my opinion about the future of this and the future amendments that might take place, but I will not probably be voting on any of them. Terry Culhane will do a majority of the speaking in the presentation process today, which we will do first. It'll be from about 20 minutes, maybe as much as a half hour, of information and about our stormwater and flood controls. And we also have distinguished members of the Department of Public Works, Doug McDonald, Director Hundley, and Jim Lorla, who are all here. They can answer technical questions, specific in nature, regarding the technical elements of what might be required or how we go about actually complying with some of the standards that we have in front of us. After the presentation from Mr. Culhane, who is the chair of the Board of Public Works, we'll take questions. Please just announce your name and where you live or where you own property or where you're from or something like that, so that we can get that on the record. And you can ask the administration, the members of the board, or myself, any kind of question that would fit into our respective expertise. All right, so without further ado, I introduce Terry Culhane, board, chair of the board.
Good evening, and thank you all for coming out. So as Owen has explained, we're here tonight. We have the first slide just to block it out. My goals tonight are, first of all, I'd like to hopefully give all of you a sense of the scale and the size of our flood control and stormwater infrastructure. It's really a substantial system. Replacement value, we've been told, would be in the neighborhood of $200 to $250 million if we're going to recreate these systems today. As you can imagine, with a system this large, there are ongoing operational requirements, maintenance requirements, basically expenses everywhere you look. Just to keep the system operational, keep moving forward, no one is asking us to make these systems state-of-the-art or silver plate them or anything particularly fancy. What we're hearing from the federal government is that they'd like to keep them operational. They would like us to keep everything in good working order and functioning properly. So we're going to talk about some of these EPA and Army Corps engineer requirements that they have been giving us. Operating the system that we have now, meeting these new requirements, is going to require more money than we have been accustomed to spending. We're going to talk tonight about what the scale of the funding that it's going to be required is, and about the city task force that was given the task of looking at the amount of money that was required and talking about the best way, trying to research the best way to assist the city to meet those expenses. All of that work resulted in an ordinance proposal, which is what's being considered by the city council at this time. explain that proposal to you. That proposal is the work, the joint work of the task force, the Board of Public Works, and what's called a joint committee of the City Council. It's a combination of the several city councilors and several members from the Board of Public Works. It's called the Joint Committee, established about 20 years ago. And then, one of the interesting things, I think, for all of us is, what would a bill look like for my house, for your house, for Cooley Dickinson Hospital, for Cooper's Corner? What are the bills going to look like if this all happens as we have proposed it? This is the picture of Pleasant Street. You can see Hotel Northampton up here. Sylvester's is over here. This is the flood in 1936. We had a series of floods in 36 and 38 up and down the Connecticut River. And the very earliest parts of Northampton were along the river. So they're the most susceptible to flooding. Go to the next slide. The flood water comes in both from the Mill River over the Smith College and the Connecticut River, and it all eventually winds up in the lowest parts of town, which are basically Hawley Street, Conn Street, Pleasant Street, Pomeroy Terrace. That whole section of the city is vulnerable to flood water. Next slide. In a moment, we're going to see a video detailing this in more detail. But basically, we have a levee system that wraps around this low section of the city, the part that you saw flooded here and here. And it's protecting us from the Connecticut River. And then we have levees over here protecting us from the Mill River. And with that, I'd like to introduce a video. Many of you know Jim Doskal. He was the director of the city's wastewater treatment plant for many years. He has worked at the department. He worked at the Department of Public Works for some 3 or 4 decades, I believe. He's a past president of City Council and has volunteered on numerous city boards, and he's just done so much for the city of Northampton. He has more of the institutional knowledge of our flood control system than possibly any other person in the city, and he's here. He's here right now, here tonight, but he's also going to be on screen giving us a quick overview of the flood control system.
Without these pumps, the city is vulnerable to flooding. There are three stop-loss structures. One at West Street, Route 66. One at the railroad crossing on Pleasant Street. And one on Route 5 by the bowling alley. The flood control dike system effectively creates a bowl around the lower portion of the city. The city has a flood control emergency plan, and it is as follows. With the river elevation 106, we close the gate on the old mill riverbed and activate the flood control step. River elevation 107, the DPW closes Suspension Bend Road and Old Springfield Road. The DPW notifies dispatch and they alert police and fire. River elevation 112, central dispatch notifies police, fire, mayor, central services, building inspector, and the Red Cross. River elevation 115 to 116, Monton Road nears flooding. Highland Road and Ferry Street residents notified. Venturesfield Road and Hockenham Road closed. Police department closes Monton Road and Atwood Drive. Fire department sets up emergency management center. At river elevation 120, the mayor decides whether to call the emergency flood board to a meeting at Carlin Drive. Emergency manager orders B&M Railroad closed. DPW closes Old Ferry Road and installs center uprights for stop lock structure at Route 5 and Monton Road. River elevation 124. The sill at the stop lock structure begins flooding Route 5. Stop lock structure at B&M Railroad is flooding. Route 5 and railroad stop lock structures are fully erected. Route 91 exit 18 honor closed. River elevation 127. The mayor requests the governor to declare a state of emergency. The DPW erects full stop lock structures on West. River elevation 130. The water is at the top of the concrete wall at the flood control station. Flood control and wastewater treatment plant personnel evacuate the zone. Flood control station has been activated 300 plus times since 1945. The gate is closed at elevation 107, protecting the inner city, and the farmland in the meadow is left vulnerable to flood. The flood control system protects Northampton from potential floods. The map shows what could happen if the dikes fail or the pumping station fails to operate. At river elevation 118, flooding the lower Pleasant Street, lower Tom Street, and Hockenham Road areas. At river elevation 127, all of Cotton Street, Veterans Field, Carson Poppy Street, and up to Bridge Street. At river elevation 137, all of Holly Street, Pleasant Street to Main, and Market to King. At elevation 147, the entire lower portion of the city would be underwater. To bring the flood control system into compliance, the city of Northampton must invest in its upkeep and maintenance. The stone riprap lining, the Mill River bed, and outside of the dike system needs to be cleared of all growth. The dikes require a 15-foot access road extending from the bottom on both sides. Any trees or structures in that zone must be removed. Parts of the Mill River need to be dredged. The flood control station may need upgrade or replacement. Future studies will determine which avenue to pursue. The Army Corps of Engineers has mandated that we do studies on the dike elevations and the flood control stations to determine cost.
Thank you.
just a couple of things, just to fill in some details of what Jim had to say earlier. The parts that are up for repair, one of those Sterling engines is down. It took us almost a month to find a vendor who could fabricate a new part. Again, there's no part to purchase. These have to be made in a machine shop. We finally found someone. The cost to do that work is going to be about $7,000. It's a fairly small part, but it's a complicated part. And it'll take a month to fabricate. If we would like a fast track, it'll cost $9,000, and it'll still take 2 weeks, I believe. That, in the scheme of things, $7,000 is not going to break the city. The problem is, if these things fail in the midst of a storm, there's no quick fix. There are no parts on the shelf. If they do fail, they're apt to fail when they're under severe stress, which is, of course, when the city needs this the most. The second piece is, it's kind of interesting. In 1938, when they began the work on the levee system and they diverted the Mill River, the river used to come, you can see little scraps of the original river behind Pond Street, behind Pleasant Street. It used to go over here near the roundhouse. Of course, those are still the low points in the city. And storm drains all over the downtown area still go into pipes that run basically downhill. So all up and down Main Street and over in the South Street neighborhoods, the pipes are going this way toward the low ground. These are the catch basins in the streets. If we have substantial rainstorm in the city, even if the Connecticut River is not high, like the one we had earlier in the week, I think that was middle of last week. We had about 2.5 inches of rain. At that point, enough rain falls on this side that although the water can normally go under a little culvert that goes below the dike, so much water accumulates that we have to turn the pumps on. And that's Jim referred to needing to turn the pumps on over 300 times over the past 70 years. It's mostly occurs when we have so much rain that the water can no longer escape under the dike. That's a variation on what Jim showed you in the video. Next slide. Basically, here's the concept of the pump station. If the river were up, we would close a gate underneath the levees and turn the pumps on to take the water that would be accumulating on the city side of the dike and force it into the high water on the river side of the dike. These pumps can, I remember once we were trying to think of a comparison to show you just how powerful these pumps are. A typical in-ground pool in someone's backyard, it could fill the pool in 7 or 8 seconds. These are prepared to handle substantial storms, a hurricane sitting on the city in combination with high water on the Connecticut Riverside. So we have these requirements that have come to us from the Army Corps of Engineers. In 1938, the City Council authorized the Mayor, William Fiker, to sign an agreement with the Army Corps of Engineers and the federal government. We, of course, wanted the government to build the levees to protect the city. And the deal they offered cities up and down the river was, if we build it, you'll maintain it. That's the deal. And late November 1938, William Fiker signed on behalf of the city, assuring the Army Corps of Engineers, it's in the chapter labeled assurances, that we would in fact maintain the dikes in perpetuity. As I said earlier, the Army is not asking us to make them fancier than they are right now, just asking us to keep them in good working order. In addition, post-Katrina, I think it's fair to say the Army Corps of Engineers has some egg on their face about the fact that clearly they were not prepared for a storm the size of Katrina down in New Orleans. So they're asking all towns and cities with Corps of Engineer constructed flood works to commission some studies to determine the seismic stability, to review all of the assumptions made in the design to make sure that these structures has anything happened in the hydrology or the meteorology that would cause us to rethink anything in the design that we have right now? They want us to go through all of those steps to at least check and make sure everything is just as it should be. Also, the Army is well aware of the fact that the flood control station that Jim mentioned and that we talked about needs a lot of work. They've identified well over $1 million worth of work that they would like us to do right away. We have started commissioning some studies to find out exactly what the details are there. We don't have an exact number yet, but it's clearly going to be in excess of $1 million to address the points that they want us to address right away. Just the engineering and the maintenance that they want us to do is going to exceed $1 million. So I'm not talking about that $1 million, I'm talking about another $1 million. Next slide. And then the other leg of stormwater is the stormwater drainage system. Basically, once you build a road with curves, everywhere where there's a little bit of a dip in the road, with the curves on the sides, you're going to get a small lake or a skating rink in the winter, unless you do something to drain the street when there's snow melting or a stormwater. Our drainage system began, the construction began in the late 1800s, and it's continued primarily through the 1960s and 70s. Most of the buildup was pretty much over by the 70s and early 80s. The drainage system is seriously under capacity in several areas, many areas, in fact. If you think about the underpass by Dunkin' Donuts on North Street, it turns into a lake every time there's a heavy rainstorm. The capacity of the stormwater drainage system in that area is simply not up to the task of removing that much water that quickly. Again, limited funds for replacing, repairing, and constructing. All of the money we've spent to date for either of these two areas, flood control or stormwater drainage, comes from the general fund. And some of these numbers are staggering. Just to conceive of going to the city and saying, listen, we need $1 million for this or that. If we lay off 8 teachers, 4 policemen, and 3 firemen, and do this or that, we could probably do it. Well, these conversations just, it's impossible to conceive of a serious conversation that went along those lines. Looking at the stormwater infrastructure, we have almost 5,000 catch basins. Those are the drains along the curbs, along the streets. We have almost 5,000 catch basins, 114 miles of pipe, 326 outfalls, and almost 200 culverts. All of this does two things. It protects, it provides safe transit for cars, and then the other thing is it prevents damaging erosion along the roads, which would be caused by the water finding its own path off the roadway. In the next slide,
what's an outfall?
Outfall is, all right, so the water goes into the pipes along the catch basins, and then we send it off to a stream, a river, a brook, a wetland, a swamp, somewhere out of our way, it's convenient to dump it.
And that point where it leaves our system is the outfall.
Pardon?
And that point where it leaves our system.
Yes, I'm sorry.
The outfall.
The outfall is the other end of the pipe.
What is a culvert?
Culvert would be, catch basin is the water goes down the drain and disappears. Culvert is we're just directing it through a little concrete channel or some kind of an arrangement to direct the water a certain way. It's all in the open, you can see it. Thank you for both of us. This is an example of a catch basin that blew out. This is on Hatfield Street. This is a high pressure gas pipe, I believe, going over the mass. It failed once the water gets going. It just can do an amazing amount of damage. And this all occurred in one storm. This was not something that took weeks to happen. This happened in a matter of 2 or 3 hours. Once it gets going, it's impossible to stop the water. So you can imagine we collect water in a typical storm like the one we had last week, 2.5 inches of rain. Tens of millions of gallons of water have to get handled by our stormwater system. And we're dumping it all in the streams, the brooks, the rivers, the swamps. Well, as you can probably won't be surprised to hear that the EPA and the Clean Water Act regulates our ability to do that. And we're required to have a permit which allows us to collect stormwater from our streets and discharge it in areas of the city that are more convenient to us. In the past, the stormwater permit, the one we have now, was issued about 10 years ago, was, I think it's fair to say, was a placeholder. They wanted to just establish the need for a permit. They wanted to start bringing cities into the fold of having permitted and inspected systems. I think if you wanted an idea of where this is all heading, you could think about that algae bloom that occurs at the end of the Mississippi River every year, and they get the algae going hundreds of miles out into the Gulf of Mexico, which creates a dead zone. The algae absorbs the oxygen, kills the fish. That's the sort of thing that they'll have to tackle on the Mississippi River, of course. But they're also thinking of the health of the Long Island Sound and of the Connecticut River as it goes down. So I think they're just sort of drawing all of the cities in, getting their infrastructure under their control so that they can slowly begin adjusting what they require of us. For our new permit, it has not been issued yet, but we've seen drafts of it. We've seen now our second draft of it. They basically want us to increase the amount of cleaning on our streets. We now struggle to clean the streets in the city once per year. Downtown gets cleaned much more frequently. Out in Leeds, sometimes they don't even get the streets only to be cleaned once a year. They want us to increase that and maybe make it as much as twice a year. Right now, it takes almost 4 months to clean the streets. Someone working basically all day, every day, all week long, for almost 3.5 to 4 months. They want to do that twice. So there's a cost associated with that. There's payroll, there's equipment, there's gasoline. You can put a cost on each one of these things. They want us to sample the water at the outfalls. They want us to sample the dry weather and wet weather. They want to inspect it to see if there's any signs that there might be sewage getting into the stormwater system. They want to take samples and send it off for analysis. Again, there's a cost to it. We can put a number to that. Nitrogen reduction. They want us to increase the number of times we clean the catch basins. We have approximately 5,000 catch basins. We clean catch basins for 8 months out of the year. We don't do it during the winter. If you assume that the crew was a 40-hour work week, every week for 8 months, they have to clean a catch basin every 16 minutes without fail. It looks like we're going to have to start cleaning some of the catch basins twice a year. Not all of them, but they want all of them cleaned at least once a year and some more than once a year. Again, we can put a dollar number on this. If we have to send out a second crew with a second truck, all of that can be budgeted for. You can turn the requirement into a budget requirement. Next slide. So before I get into this, I'd just like to take a second. And we're not focusing on the budget in these meetings, because I think what most of you want to know about is what's the bottom line? Where are we going with this? What's this going to mean? But basically, if you take the new expenses that I sort of discussed here briefly, plus what the city is currently spending, plus you take all of the debt service that the city is currently paying for past projects in the past 10 or 15 years, and then you add in the benefits for the employees that work on this stuff, and then put in a relatively modest budget for new projects. That number is $500,000. Let me just speak to that for a moment. North Street, obviously, is not too far away from here.
$500,000?
For new work.
Okay.
For 1 year? Yes. Let me speak to that for a second. Take the North Street repaving job. As you know, it just happened. The water pipes under the street were paid for by the Water Enterprise Fund. The paving, we got some state money for. through Chapter 90. Sewer pipes were paid for by the Sewer Enterprise Fund. The last piece were the catch basins and the stormwater pipe. That money came out of the general fund here in the city. That project was postponed for 3 years because the city wasn't able to come up with the $225,000 necessary to do the stormwater pipes. You may have noticed that since that project started and then it languished, or it's kind of hard to tell what's happened. That we were waiting for the city to have the money from the general fund to pay for the stormwater piece of that project. As major as that project was, as substantial as that project was, if we were to do a project just like that every single year without fail, given the length of pavement on North Street, it would take us 130 years to do all the other streets before we could get back to North Street to do it over again. In other words, it took several years for the city to come up with the money to do that. And yet, even if the city was able to do that every single year, it's not nearly enough to keep up with the need. Add it all together, and you come up with a budget of somewhere between $1.5 and $2 million a year to comply with all the new regulations and to maintain what we already have. We brought that number to the city, talked to city councilors, talked to the mayor, and the decision was made to create a stormwater task force laid out, as you see here, to look at the problem and see if they had any recommendation on how the city ought to fund this. So they met for about 4 months. They met every single week. Okay. They looked at what are the possibilities. Currently, we pay for this from the general fund, that is property taxes. Everyone says, how about overrides? The problem with an override, they quickly realized, is that you can't borrow money, bond it, if you can't guarantee the payment, repayment. As the amount of money required year to year goes up and down, you can't keep going back over and over. We need a little override, a bigger override this year. Now we need one. You can't run a business, in the sense this is a small business. You can't run a business if you can't predict an income stream. They considered a fee. And they considered combinations. For example, Westfield has kind of a combination of general fund and a fee. They're not particularly happy about it. It's not working very well, but that's the direction that they chose. Okay. Yes?
What about just borrowing money?
Well, you have to pay it back.
Well, I remember it came back a bit, but pay it back eventually. So you can borrow it now and make sure there's no worry about.
It's hard. I mean, in big sections of it would be akin to borrowing money to buy a TV, borrowing against your house to buy a TV. Bonds are long-term. It's a long-term borrowing, and it's best you made it up with long-term capital projects. We couldn't be, I don't think it would be wise to borrow long-term money to pay this year's payroll, for example, because we have to pay the payroll again next year and the year after that. And yet we'd still be paying the first year's payroll 20 years from now.
But this is like physical stuff.
The physical stuff we will borrow. Yes. I mean, it's a problem. Even at today's low interest rates, and interest rates for bonds for a city are around 2%. If you borrow $1 million and pay it back over 20 years, you're looking at several hundred thousand dollars in interest over the 20 years, even at 2%. So there's a tail on this. It looks great the first year, and you borrow here, you borrow there, and suddenly, today, the city pays over $1 million a year in interest on public works infrastructure. And quickly, that interest turns into a real problem.
As taxpayers, we sit here and listen to all this, I wonder, has anyone actually gone through the city to really see if there's any money getting wasted somewhere, where that could be all caught up? Have you tightened your belt so that you know in your mind that you're not wasting this amount of money somewhere else? Instead of asking the taxpayers for the money, why can't we go into the city and say, here, we're wasting this, wasting this, wasting this, I think we'll have the money.
The scale of this problem.
Maybe an odd concept. You gotta start thinking about
that. That'd be a good question for the city council at the end.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, as I'm looking at this, just bear with me, okay, who's gonna benefit from this? And I'm thinking, you know, the hurricane, Katrina and everything, we have FEMA. Does FEMA want us to have a flood? I mean, if we do this, isn't FEMA gonna benefit from not having to carry that insurance? We're not gonna be at risk, you know, when you're doing risk analysis. So the insurance company and the homeowner's insurance, and if you're in a floodplain, and who lends money? Insurance companies collect money and they lend it. So I'm thinking, if we go and do this, can we go to some of these insurance companies, whether it be Liberty Mutual Home Insurance or Allstate or whatever, and say, you know, can we get a reduced interest rate or something? Is there a benefit? Because you're gaining at the same time we are.
Right.
And see if we can't hit some of these, you know, major lenders to get a better rate or something, because they're going to benefit in the long run the same time, you know, by us putting out and doing these things.
Do you mind if I answer the questions as they come up, or would people, is that all right? Okay. This doesn't precisely answer your question, but I hope it will speak to that area. FEMA draws the flood maps, which determine which properties are required to buy flood insurance and which ones don't have to. Right now, they rate levies on a three-part scale. They're either acceptable, they're minimally acceptable, which is the situation we're in here, or they're the third category, rather than unacceptable, it's also called inactive. So we have minimally acceptable levies. They'd like us to bring them up to acceptable, but if we say no, we can't afford it, we don't have the money, or we can't do it quickly enough, whatever our answer may be, if we basically say no, then the next step is they'll be declared inactive, and then when FEMA redraws the flood maps, and I hope this is roughly speaking to your thought, they'll draw them so that, if you remember the map, so that they kind of go up into the neighborhoods. And all of a sudden, all of the people who live on Pauley, Pomeroy Terrace, Conn Street will have to buy flood insurance. I asked my bank what would happen in Northampton Cooperative Bank, and they said, of course, that would be big local news. And Northampton Cooperative said that they would go through their files, find all of the people inside the new flood line, and require them to buy flood insurance or force place it on those properties if they have a mortgage. So, I don't know that we would get a break for doing this, but we can avert a bigger problem by doing this.
I think it would still be in good interest to go to some of these major insurers and say, you know, the risk analysis of these homes and stuff, it's a major project, you're lending to a city where they want and what cap, you know, credit rating. You know, what can you do for us? Because I think out there, there's a lot of money, and they're looking for good projects, and they can't find it today, and I think we could get a reduced rate if you do it the right way. I think you could probably, because they're going to benefit too.
All right, thank you. Well, Owen has a thought on that.
So, I actually would like you to finish the presentation so we can take questions, and we don't feel as though we're giving preferential treatment to people with their questions as they come to them. But with my speaking, as with my other hat on, I do insurance and financial services for a living, so I can talk about both of them. First of all, I can give you a lot of assurance that homeowner insurers, fire insurers, do not care that if your home is flooded, because it's actually an exclusion from their policy. So in effect, if your home is flooded and lost, they have collected premium for many years and have never had to pay it out to you. So in effect, they're benefiting. And flood insurance is a different type of insurance from homeowners insurance. So if everywhere that would be affected by flood, by the redrawn flood maps, would be everyone who wants to protect their home, and especially if they have a mortgage on it, they would have to purchase usually very expensive, $2,000, $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 a year policies, depending on the style of, if it's a home, and if it's a business, if it's a commercial property, it's even more expensive. So by maintaining the levy system, at least for the biggest commercial district the city has, we'll be protecting huge cost increase. The other thing I can say is that borrowing, we're gonna have to borrow to complete some of these capital projects. Borrowing is not, creating a bond is not like a corporate bond where there's a balloon payment, where you just make interest over the years and then one balloon payment after 30 or something like that. Municipal lending, it amortizes the loans. So with that, it's a lot like a mortgage where all your part of every payment you make is both interest and principal. So that's, in effect, you have to come up with the money as you go. And that's what the city does with debt exclusion overrides, for instance, for the police station or something like that. And it's very possible that we're going to have to create to bond, but it wouldn't be a good solution. So it's like for some of the expenses, just as Mr. Colhane said, for some of the expenses, you'd be bonding to pay current salaries or maintenance, which is really not a good solution. You want to borrow for capital projects. And the final thing regarding, sir, your question about savings. We've been through a couple of very tough budgets, and there are savings still, I believe, to be found in the budget. But the mayor has done a very good job at curtailing spending. Mary instituted, upon arriving in office, instituted a policy of all expenditures over $100 must be personally approved by him. And that did create some savings, but the type of savings that we have, that we would be looking for, it cannot be found in the budget. There is not $2 million of fat in Northampton's budget. There may be $100,000 or $200,000 here and there, but there is not $2 million. And it's not in a sustainable way. It can't be found in a sustainable fashion. Maybe we might be able to find some savings for a year or two, but then the pressures at other parts of the budget would be up, and we would not be able to do that effectively. Thank you. And please continue.
Okay. So, task force came back in August July with a recommendation. They did, in fact, recommend that of the various ways to fund a budget on the scale of $1.5 to $2 million, fee was the way that they thought would be most effective. They suggested a couple of formulas for determining the individual bills, and they recommended that we have a program that offered credits and incentives for people to basically encourage best practices, best stormwater behavior. In August, the City Council accepted the task force, and they asked the Board of Public Works and the Joint Committee to continue the work of the task force. As I said a moment ago, the task force suggested two possible alternatives for calculating a bill. Well, the City Council asked us to winnow that down to one. They suggested credits, but they didn't specifically identify exactly which credits they ought to be or how much the credit ought to be. So there's still work to be done on the foundation of what the task force had already accomplished. We created a couple of subcommittees. We worked in-house. The full Board of Public Works worked on this. The Joint Committee worked on this. And we made a public presentation on September 18th showing everyone what we had come up with to date. There's quite a bit of feedback. And we actually found some of that feedback really helpful. We went back, reworked it some more, and finally brought it to the City Council at the end of, actually it was early in October, I think. Next slide. So let's get to the draft ordinance now. is that the size of a parcel is directly connected to the amount of the stormwater field. But it's not as simple as just saying, you've got 40,000 square feet, do the math, there's your bill. Pavement, roofs, contribute much more to runoff. We're trying to look at the runoff profile of properties. Pavement and roofs, the water runs off right away. There's no way for it to soak in. An acre of farmland, an acre of forest, an acre of grass, on the other hand, the water can soak in to some extent. Now, in the winter, when the ground is frozen, it runs off of everything. But broadly speaking, grass is good, farmland is good, forest is good. And broadly speaking, roofs and pavement, that runs off all the time. So we came up with a weighting scheme. This was as recommended basically by the task force. And each square foot of impervious surface gets multiplied by 0.95. So 1,000 square feet melts down to 950 square feet. Basically, a square foot remains a square foot. On the other hand, for pervious surface, farmland, grass, forest land, the multiplier is 0.1. So 1,000 square feet of pervious surface melts down to 100 square feet. In this manner, you can come up with the adjusted, the weighted size of a parcel of land. Also, I think it's a little further down here. A decision was made, I don't see it immediately, but a decision was made to cap pervious building at 1 acre. So if you have 10 acres of farmland, the bill will be for 1 acre, and then times 0.1. If you have 50 acres of farmland, the bill's going to be for 1 acre. So the maximum billing for pervious property is 1 acre. We have about 6,601 to three-family homes in Northampton. And the decision was made to group them together and give each group a standard bill, rather than trying to generate individual bills all the way down each street. Actually, I'll talk about this in a moment, because the next slide makes this much easier to see. So there's 6,600 smaller residential properties that are going to get standardized bills. I'll discuss that in a second. The other approximately 2,600 properties, which for the first time, well, it's one of the benefits of a fee, these properties are going to include the nonprofits, churches, Smith College, Cooley Dickinson. They're going to include city properties, this property, city hall, parking lots. Everyone gets a bill, basically.
Even the feds.
Even who?
Even the feds. The VA.
Yes. Next slide. Let's go back to the residential bills. Now, this is a satellite photo with false colors showing the impervious area. So with satellite data and the city's database, we can do this all over the city. And the computer can fairly quickly spit out how many square feet of impervious surface is here, or here, or here. You can see this property is a little bit bigger than this property. Essentially, the plan is, if the impervious area on a property is less than 2,000 square feet, which would be my house, for example, a modest house, a small, a short driveway, a lot of properties are going to fall into that category. Typical bill would be $61 a year if the annual budget that year was $2 million. If the annual budget that year was $1 million, it would be $30.50. So it's directly proportional. But basically, that would be the bill for a small residential property. Between 2,000 and 4,000 square feet of impervious surface, the bill would be $97. Again, based on a $2 million annual budget. And finally, for those properties, large properties over 4,000 square feet of impervious surface, $233 is the anticipated bill. So those 6,600 properties are going to get standardized bills, as I just described. All of the other properties will calculate their bill property by property. So for example, you can see here, Cooley Dickinson has a substantial amount of impervious property, and they have over 1 million square feet of pervious property. Grass, weeds, the woods down along Federal Street, I think it is. So to calculate their bill, the impervious area is 61,000 square feet. The net, the actual is 685 times the multiplier, 0.95. The net is 651. 1,100,000 square feet of pervious, capped at 1 acre, which is 43,000 square feet, times the 0.1 multiplier, we get a combination of 655,000 square feet of adjusted area. You just do the math again with that $2 million annual budget, and Cooley Dickinson bill would be $15,500 under that scenario. And we would do the same thing for Cooper's Corner, Leah Honda, Smith College, Northampton High School, properties all over the city.
So give me the property. After right. A few years, you know them anyway.
Okay. There are proposals for incentives, credits for forest driveways, rain gardens. Probably the largest potential beneficiary of these credits might be like a car dealer who put some real money and effort into arranging drainage swales. But we will have a system of credits for protected land. There'll be an education credit. So this will be all part of the plan. The planning department has been encouraging us to consider having outright exemptions for those lands with permanent conservation restrictions or agricultural preservation restrictions. Their argument is that they have to work awfully hard to get people to consider donating their land, and they'd like to offer every incentive they possibly can. In the scheme of things, if we exempt these properties, the ones that we have on the record right now, it does not amount to too much in the scheme of things, about $15,000 to $17,000 annually. But this is under discussion. There are people I know on the city council who feel like that particular exemption is not a good idea. The task force was very clear that they thought everyone should get a bill. So there's some pushback about carving out even these two reasonably needing. They're worthy. Even these two worthy exemptions are getting some discussion. Another thing is there are farmers, and this is particularly pertinent perhaps here in Ward 3. There are farmers with multiple parcels down in the meadows, or with parcels in the meadows and woodlots in other parts of the city. And it's not our intention to penalize them in a sense by giving them 10 bills if they happen to have 10 pieces of 10 parcels down in the meadows that they're farming. So in cases where there's a single owner of multiple open parcels of land, there will only be one bill. It will consider one large property for billing purposes. Again, the 1 acre cap, that's how we propose to solve that. It's almost a special situation.
Do they have to be contiguous?
No. One owner, open land. Next, there'll be a process to appeal the bill. This is all, once this formula goes through, it's just math. There's nothing arbitrary about it. It's simple math. If a property owner feels we have made a mistake in the measurements, if they feel we should be, the gross area, acreage is wrong, or the amount of impervious surface is wrong, we'd like to fix that. So it should be a pretty straightforward thing. Bring it to our attention, we'll take care of it. If some issue remains unresolved, there's an appeals process.
I'm confused on the Cooley Dickinson Hospital at the $15,000. You only charge them for 1 acre.
Of pervious.
Okay, it was the impervious that increased level.
Yeah, they have 600 and
50,000 square feet of impervious.
Okay, I understand.
And they pay virtually full rate for that.
I see. And would it matter if you had a for instance, my property, I put in a complete drainage system to satisfy the first 6 hour flood from a storm. Does that matter?
At the moment, it doesn't affect your bill.
Yeah,
At the moment, that doesn't play into your bill.
Okay. Maybe I don't get this, but it seems to me for almost every house in the city, unless there's something exceptional about it, it's going to cost about $50-some or $90-some. Is that it? You get a single, you don't calculate the square foot. If it's up to a certain amount, it's what is it, 67 or 57,
right?
If it's between that and another,
right,
then it's 97. And how many houses in the city will be paying more than $97?
About 1,000.
What does it take to do? What kind of houses that have?
And it could have a large driveway, a parking area, a basketball court, a tennis court, a long low house rather than a high house. It'll be a larger property. I mean, let's face it.
Another question, a lot of condos away, and a lot of them have streets all over the place.
They don't fall into this small residential category. So they would be, that condo association would be built with an individually calculated bill for that part.
Also, the intention of the city to get water rebuilt, so it's $100, $25 water.
Next slide. We have handouts here. These are some sample bills. The VA Medical Center, Smith College, Three County Fairgrounds, Hotel Northampton, CVS, Cooper's Corner, Paradise Copies. We have copies of these sample bills. It's too small to read up here, but you're welcome to pick up a copy if you'd like, if you're curious about what the bills might look like.
In the calculation using the roof, some lockers have gutters that lead down downspouts and go into a pervious hole. So the water actually does not just go off into the street necessarily. Some might think it's pumped up, but that's not included in this. In other words, you just take the roof, the area of the roof, and that's it. Whether you go into a rain barrel or you go into
There are a couple of issues. So his question is, what if you have gutters on the house that go down into a little underground sump or a basin, some kind of an area where it can sink into the soil? We have examples all over the city where very well-intentioned stormwater runoff systems were built for developments and for larger buildings, and after a while they don't work very well if they're not maintained. It's very difficult for us to determine how effective any particular one of these is. And the larger commercial ones, we've already realized, we're going to have annual or biannual, semi-annual inspections just to make sure they still deserve the credit that they're applying for.
I just have a question about
Smith
College.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it applies to some of these other institutions as well. Are you looking at Smith College as a single parcel or as a collection of parcels? I know you said you didn't want to give.
It's not open land.
It's not open land?
Right.
So they're getting separate bills based upon their different parcels.
Yeah. That earlier thing is more oriented toward the agricultural sector. It's very common down the meadows to have multiple parcels that you.
But Smith would be getting separate bills based upon separate parcels. That's how that's calculated, too?
Yes. Next slide. So this is kind of an interesting slide. Right now we pay, as we've talked about, using property taxes in the general fund. The interesting thing about a fee is that everyone pays their water bill, everyone pays their sewer bill, everyone pays fees. So the entities that are non-profit or for some reason non-taxable, we do pay fees. So right now, using our current property tax, 83% of all the income is from residential properties, and 17% is commercial and industrial. That's the whole pie of the source of income for our general fund. Under our proposal, just over 50% would come from residential for the stormwater fee. 24% would be commercial and industrial. Municipal properties would account for 9% of the income. The nonprofit tax-exempt sector, Smith College, Cooley Dickinson, churches, private schools, 10%. Other would be forest, you know, open land, forest, agriculture. So it really spreads the fee out much more evenly across all the different sectors of the city.
The other is so small because of the definition we use for our open land, no charge per acre, for 1 acre than that common law.
It's true. Yeah. If we didn't do that weighted, to some extent, you come up with a scheme and you try it. And we were running the bills with some of the early ideas. The task force, a couple members of the task force are here, the task force worked for weeks on this. And some schemes that seem pretty reasonable on paper, you run the numbers and the farmers are getting hammered. But we had, you know, Grow Food Northampton has the new property out in Florence. They were getting bills of thousands of dollars for their agricultural. I think one was as high as $10,000. That was, we were getting unintended results with some of the schemes. So that was frankly an attempt to address the problem of not hammering open land to make to put this together.
Some folks might consider that preferential treatment.
I suppose, and you know, the city council has their work cut out for them to sort through this. That's what you see here is made it through almost a year of process with input from dozens and dozens of people. But we may not have it right.
We actually do a bond in the money.
Let me just finish. I'm like one slide from being done, and then we can go to the questions.
Moving forward,
the draft ordinance, the proposal, has been given to the City Council. They've referred the ordinance to subcommittees like the Ordinance Subcommittee, the Youth Commission, EDLU, which I'm not quite sure what that means, but that's one of the subcommittees. And, of course, as you all know, and we're here tonight. We're having ward meetings all over the city to expose people to this, to get your comments, and to answer questions. And at some point, the full City Council is going to have to deliberate and vote on this. And as Owen indicated earlier, it looks like that might be probably after the inauguration of the City Council. That concludes our portion of the website, northamptonmass.gov. All sorts of information. If you'd like to see a video of a presentation made a year ago, this is the place to find it. If you'd like to look at articles in the Hampshire Gazette or the Springfield Republican from 2 or 3 years ago, it's all right here, all the links. If you'd like to read the requirement letters from the Army Corps of Engineers, it's all there. As deeply as you'd like to delve into this, the information is available on the website. If you have detailed questions after you've read every single word on the website, not before, then you can call Jim Laurel of the City Engineer, and he would be happy to answer detailed questions. And of course, check the city camp calendar to follow the process as it goes through the City Council deliberation. So at this point, it's open to questions, and of course, Pamela Schwartz is here from Ward 4. Owen is here from Ward 3. We have the staff of the Department of Public Works. If you have a real specific technical question, you think they might be people to ask. And of course, I'll answer.
One question.
Okay.
How much are we charging Williamsburg and that town to go down the road to us?
Do you wonder any idea? What was that question?
He wondered whether we can charge Williamsburg and Haydenville for the water they're sending down the Mill River towards us.
We got to take care of it. We got to pump it. Why shouldn't they pay?
That'd be a tough one. You know, not a bad idea.
I think they're paying for the sewer there, though.
Oh, yeah. We
don't pay for stormwater.
We handle the sewer. There's a sewer system in the center of Williamsburg, and that comes down a pipe down past the sanitarium and leads past Shark Pack, and we treat their sewage here at the wastewater treatment plant.
Which comes to mind.
Yes?
I have sewer in Williamsburg. I do not have sewer in Northampton.
Wow.
Where are you?
South Street.
The other side of the bridge?
The other side of the bridge.
Okay. Okay.
When is that going to happen?
All right, so there are any questions people have? That was a statement. I remember. Can I speak quickly? Just to clarify a couple of things. Sir, you were talking about how you install this as a stormwater system, either through...
City made me do it.
The city made you do it probably as a condition of your permit.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
So I think that when Mr. Colleen said that the ordinance has no provision for you, he's right. There isn't a provision there. But I do believe that the board, and please correct me if I'm wrong, that the board will be working on a credit system for those properties. Most of them have been more recently created, that have created stormwater infrastructure of their own, either to hold it back or to reduce the flow or something like that. And I believe that there will be a credit system available for your properties. It probably won't be 100% credit, but it's part of the law that credits like that will be applicable. And I think that the engineers will work on a fair credit, which you'll be able to appeal.
And the sewer line, will that come?
The sewer, I believe, is a completely...
Not on the table tonight.
Yeah.
Just to expand on what Owen just said, if this comes to pass, then at some point we need to integrate what we're doing in terms of the credits, for example, with what the planning department is requiring in terms of getting building permits, what they're asking people to do for stormwater on properties. So we're just not there yet where what we're working on and what the planning department is working on is kind of brought together and rationalized. Mm-hmm. But clearly that has to come.
Yeah. Okay. Can I also point out the question that this gentleman asked about water running off roofs into gutters and then onto grass or something like that. I'm not the engineer, but I believe what's going on there is that water's being displaced, and that grass or dirt or whatever is being, it would be saturated at a much higher level, much more quickly. And so they're trying to account for that extra amount of saturation that does. Once that land fills, the water runs off of it, just as it would if it were a heavier rainstorm.
One question. I don't know if you mentioned this. When you showed those gigantic pumps, and they look like very ancient, are those going to be physically replaced with a modern pump?
We have to.
Yeah.
It's all a matter of time.
You said there were three of them, right?
Yes.
Oh, there's two?
Two very old. One is merely old.
One is merely old. Two have to be
replaced. Two are ancient.
So those things... Oh, that's part of the plan, to get rid of those old ones and have modern ones. And the modern ones, but the modern ones would be way more efficient, I assume, right? Be able to pump much more water.
Or
not
necessarily.
They made no improvements in 40 years?
It depends upon first possibility of putting electric pumps in there rather than diesel or whatever.
Yeah.
And if they marry them to the existing pumps that are there, then it won't increase the output. It would have to be new all the way into the wet well and through the wall.
You're talking about the engines that you're replacing. We're actually hoping we don't have to replace the pumps, because at that point we have to blow the building up and do it again. And now we're looking at tens of millions of dollars. So we would prefer to think of a way to just replace the engines.
A couple questions. The first one is, when you're talking about farmland, how much would you charge for an acre of land under the system? I mean, if there's only 1 acre.
$103.
$103 for an acre. Okay, because I'm just trying, I thought it'd be lower than that because it's just grass, but it's still that high.
Most of the other side is like it.
Okay, the other question I have is, how does this additional cost to the average homeowner compared to the sewage bill, the water bill, the sewage pipeline that we pay for? What is the difference between, let's say, an average annual cost for each one?
Average annual cost for sewer is around $500, water and sewer together.
Depends on the size of the family.
That's a four, that's 2 kids.
Family of four.
Four is closer to $800 for both water and sewer.
All right, so $450 and $450 a year.
Okay.
Water, sewer.
And this would cost them how much?
$100.
Less than $7 for most people, not more than 97.
Correct.
So it's like $150. Or less,
yes.
But can I point out that while we're talking about the bills, the bill is on $2 million budget, which is, and the law is written currently, the way it's proposed is that the first 5 years is a maximum of $2 million budget. You can't increase for the first 5 years. That number, though, is assuming that no one gets any credit. So if you assume a $2 million budget and some businesses, some properties or what have you are getting credits, then you're going to have to make that up from the other full payers. So the 63 or the 97 could go up based on the amount of credits that are being offered throughout the city.
I mean, the reason I'm comparing it, I'm trying to see what this number is and how badly and how hard everybody in the city will be affected by this. Because the importance of this is not only to save those of us who are here from floods and that kind of thing, but I assume this will last 50 years or something like that. So we're leaving this to next other generations, just like we have pipes and things like that that they built and highways and things like that. So when you approach this kind of a thing, you have to say, well, we're living off those other folks very nicely for a very long time. The least we can do is leave it to our children.
Yeah, I think that's good. Good question.
I saw in your pie chart that the city is going to pay 9% of the cost.
Yes.
For the city buildings and so forth. Where does that money come from?
Tax.
So we're going to pay the speed and we're going to pay higher property taxes.
Yep.
Well,
yeah. It's true. You're paying a little bit both ways. You know, it forces the city to put. If you look all across society, there are places where people are they're doing something without having to deal with some of the associated costs. The tobacco companies for years made a product that we know drives up health costs, but they didn't have to deal with it. They were disassociated from that expense. That expense was happening somewhere else in the system.
Well,
now, if the city
$18,000 isn't going to drive up health costs?
Of course it will, but if we don't charge them, then that cost is hidden to them. The point is, making people have to deal with this. This is not a hidden cost. It's in the past, it's been somewhere over here. All of this infrastructure has been dealt with and maintained, but it was invisible to all of us. If the price is on the table, this is my share of making this stuff work, then you have to deal with it. Maybe you've got to cut somewhere else. Maybe you've got to make some different choices.
Can I also speak to that, sir? That element of the proposed ordinance is, I believe it's a political compromise. There are many people in the city, including many representatives from the Chamber of Commerce, who very serious that the city should pay. The city should pay out of its general fund. And I have myself personally defended the opposite, that the city should not pay. Because if the city pays, essentially everybody paying the same, exactly what you're saying. But Mr. Colhane makes a very good point that imagine the city administrators not having to pay, then there will be no incentive for them to institute any kind of stormwater control in their parking lots or on their rooftops, or for them to convert any of the municipal, you know, parking areas into more pervious areas. So by making the city pay, you're giving the city administrators, whom I know it's hard to believe, not everyone trusts the city administrators, you're giving them some incentive to reduce that cost the city pays, and as Mr. Coyne said, not just ignore it, to say, wow, whatever, it's made up by other people's fees. So I do think that there's some value to having the city pay, even though I also would agree with you that you're just taking it out of one pocket and putting it in the
other. We're all paying.
Yeah, that's right. I understand. But the not only is it a political debate that's happening, and that the business entities in the city are very much want the city to pay. But the other element is that it will give the city some incentive to reduce its runoff, which is a good one. So those are the two things. That's all I can say.
Could you go back a couple of slides?
Just Jim pointed something out. Just worth thinking about. Right now, residential properties pay the lion's share of all the bills. Here, it's a much more favorable distribution. I think it's being spread more evenly across the whole city. I get your point, and as Owen has said, it's been a hot debate: should the city or should the city not get a bill? But one thing that Jim was just pointing out is this distribution, especially for residential properties, is more attractive.
You said it on 230 before the engineers came in here and built our roof down and put in the flood control system, and the city has farm paper to maintain it?
Yes.
Well, we have the National Guard, we have Westover. I know Westover has engineers. I know they're looking for projects. I know they like to help out cities. Has anybody gone and talked to Westover and see if they'd be willing to bring their crews out here and at least do like hearing exams and stuff that were originally done by the Army Corps of Engineers? It's a federal project. Is it not FEMA is making us do this?
No, it's actually the Army Corps of Engineers.
You know, but I mean, we do have resources. Why don't we go to seriously, if nobody's called Westover and talked to the engineering people up there and said, you know, we got this project, can you help us out with it?
It's
that's yours, that's all you.
Sorry, tax dollars at work.
No. It'd be like saying, I mean, I get it, they're engineers at Westover, but these are really expensive projects. And essentially, it'd be going to say, hey, wouldn't you like to kick in $500,000 or $1 million for something? And I think we can guess what their answer is.
Especially since Springfield and Chicopee and
West Springfield,
all along the Connecticut River.
Up and down the river, same thing. Enfield.
Have you tried?
No, we have not tried. I don't believe we have.
Can I ask the question a little differently?
Sure.
Have all federal and state grant opportunities been exhausted to spend to fix our levy system?
Doug McDonald would be just the guy to answer this.
No programs.
There are
there are no programs for grants that help with levies or flood control systems.
That's a city engineer. There's just nothing right now. Between the sequester and the logjam in Washington, the state budget is tight. No one is offered. Any money that's available now is for undertaking new initiatives. Fixing the old stuff is a very low priority in terms of grant money at this time.
I'm not talking about grant money. I'm talking about
Fred Dimmick has a point. I think
I don't remember it, but I sent, I believe, Jim and Ned an email about 2 months ago, and there was an article on WFCR about the governor possibly increasing money for flood control, and the cities could apply for grants. And I don't remember the organization that does that, But it sounded to me when I looked at their webpage, they were giving money to cities and towns for flood control. What was the name of the organization?
Well, it's the State Department of Conservation and Recreation.
No, it wasn't that.
Jim Lowell.
So there was a new law recently passed that made a limited amount of grant money available across the state for repair of dams, high hazard dams, in poor condition, and also for seawalls, but not for flood control. So those two specific types of structures were covered under that grant program, so not something that would help us out with this program. The city did apply for a grant to help offset some of the costs for the Upper Roberts Final Dam removal under that program.
It's a different program. I'll have to go back and look at it, but they were, the governor was going to increase it by like 50%. It's a huge amount of money. You have to go and apply for it.
So let me just cut. This has a factual answer, but what I can say is that the city, the DPW, and the mayor have done a very good job of getting state, federal, and private grants from most places available. And I can assure you that the continuing administration will continue to look for every opportunity to get federal, state, and outside funds for any part of this system. Mr. Do you have a question in the back there, sir?
Yeah, I have a question. I mean, we have lots of cities down the river and the other rivers in the eastern part. How are other cities facing? I mean, does everybody have this simultaneously, or is this just Northampton's turn? And maybe next year or the following year, the Holyoke gets its turn, and so on and so on. I just wonder what's happening, and because some of these towns, I think their financial situation might not be as good as ours.
Chicopee is already further, they already got this in place. Westfield has this in place. The cities along the Connecticut River, and then you hop over to the Mississippi River, the cities along the Mississippi River are getting the brunt of this first. Our flood control system is one of the largest ones in the state. It's the second oldest one in the state. We read about these houses on the beach down in New Jersey. They're living in a somewhat high hazard place, and I think many of us feel it's reasonable that they should bear the brunt of that and not come to the taxpayers looking for bailouts every time there's a big storm. We happen to live on a river. We live on one of the major rivers in the Northeast, and I'm afraid there are some extra costs associated with living alongside the Connecticut River.
Are the other cities charging this money, getting the money from their citizens in the same manner?
Yeah. Chicopee is a little bit different. They have a commercial rate and a residential rate. You know, in Westfield, as I mentioned earlier.
It's our rainwater.
It's what?
Square foot of your price for rainwater.
Yes.
That's how it's all.
Yeah. But, so it's the runoff characteristics of the property.
Question. I'm Rick Clark. I was on the task force. I know the question about the city paying was very much discussed in the task force. I don't think our recommendations, either one of them, included the city paying after a lot of deliberations. So that decision came after the task force. So it is a political decision, that part of the budget, or that part of the funding. The other thing I wanted to ask and just suggest, along with what this woman has been saying about Westover and other resources, a big part of the cost is the engineering, and they do have resources like that. And what you just said about this being the oldest or second oldest, it could rate with some agencies as a project they might want to take on. So I would encourage the city, if we're saying that we're doing everything, let's actually do it. Let's ask. Even if we just get laughed at.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing that I want to point out, the task force was given sort of an urgency about the meetings. We did meet over the spring and summer, and we were facing a deadline to get a recommendation to Paul Spector and the city council. So we did not examine every possible way of doing this. We did what we could as far as what was provided to us. The city really had great resources with the engineers giving us all the math and figuring out, you know, a lot of the questions that we had. But we certainly didn't cover everything that's possible and how to fund this. And one thing in particular that's kind of stuck with me that I discovered soon after the task force was done, that, and you said this at the beginning, Terry, that the streets are part of the conveyance system of this system, of the storm system. We invest a lot in curbing, in asphalt, and so there are towns out west that have implemented a fee onto the excise tax of vehicles. And to me, that seems like a fair, a reasonable option to examine, because we do have a lot of renters in Northampton that use the streets, that spreading this cost out a little bit more evenly seems to fulfill the fair and equitable sort of task that we were given. So I'm sorry that didn't get discussed in the task force or other possible methods of funding this, but I do encourage, I'm glad to see that the city is not trying to get this, that we're doing these forums and we're actually getting some feedback on this. We've waited a long time to address this problem. I'm more concerned about the system itself than the flood control. The flood control is a major issue, but we have ignored the system itself for so long. If you go back to that picture you have where the catch basin blew out, that pipe is a rusted piece of corrugated metal, and it's all over the city like that. So I'm very happy that the city's moving forward with funding this, but I do want us to examine every possible way of funding these things. And volunteer work is, you don't know if you don't ask. So I think there's engineers that might, lend a hand. So keep that option open.
Thank you. Since the gentleman brought it up again, I'd just like to say that pipe we're talking about that was part of the presentation on Hatfield Street is directly behind my residence, and the comment that you made was that it was blown out by one storm, and that's not true.
No.
That pipe deteriorated over a period of 15 years. And it was fixed a number of times by the DPW and then allowed to just go higher and become a safety hazard. All the time, all over those 15 years, that this was reported to the DPW and the planning office.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to stop using it as an example.
All right.
That, as I understand it, was repaired about 2 years ago under an emergency situation, and the city paid some $30,000 or $40,000 to repair that, and there was no need to spend that. It's a burr under my saddle, and that's all I'm going to say about it.
Thank you.
But I have a number of other questions.
Okay.
First of all, there's a lot of talk about mandates. Do you have the documents that indicate the mandates?
It's all on the website.
I have no access to
it. It's also, I think, in libraries, and there are hard copies at the Department of Public Works.
Is there some way that I'm from Ward 1. I'm sorry. I don't mean to take up anybody's time from 3 or 4. I just didn't know if I could make the meeting tomorrow.
They come in the form mostly of letters from the from the federal government.
I'd like to see them and how they're worded.
Yeah. So if we could just come to the
meeting. Is there any way you can bring those to the meeting tomorrow?
Sure.
Yeah. Thank you. The pie chart. The city 9%. I still don't understand why that makes sense for us to pay, for the city to pay out of property tax money 9%.
Does anyone here think that makes sense? Could you raise your hand if you think it makes sense for the city to pay?
I'm not finished with my question. They can have their entitled to their opinion. The
residential, again, would be paying the lion's share of that because they pay the lion's share of the property tax, and I don't see that as fair. In terms of your breakdown into three groups for the residential properties, I happen to take my property and I come over the 4,000 square feet. But I took my neighbor's property and he happens to come out to be about just under 4,000 square feet. At the same time, all of his drainage goes into the street, whereas my entire property, the drainage drains directly into a brook. Why do I have to pay 2.5 times as much?
All right, Sam.
Yeah.
Obviously, I don't have a.
Yeah, that, I didn't expect you to have an instance.
Okay.
It's more of a comment than a question.
Right, I got you.
And I understand, you know, are we going to break it down into 50 groups? I understand that. Get into these situations where it's just
basically any breakdown is going to, on a micro level, create boomers and doers.
Jared?
We have a particular problem in Ward 3 with the William Street Brook, which runs from Sheldon Field, behind all the properties, a lot of them on Bridge Street, Conroy Terrace, and William Street. It's really in rugged shape. It collects water from all the properties along, and it needs to be rebuilt. Is this the kind of thing that this stormwater fee is meant to address among?
Yes. Okay. It's precisely. We have projects all over the city, like that. Below Musanti Beach, the water flows over the large dam past Musanti Beach, and then it goes down and turns a corner and runs down Water Street and Leeds. Right where it turns the corner, it's eroding toward a house. And of course, that home, the trees are beginning to fall in his backyard. He's concerned about that. It's kind of a stormwater problem, and we have no source of money to fix that. We have no source of money right now to deal with the William Street Brook. The whole fairgrounds. We're told that there's money available to build a new arena for the fairgrounds. We're told that a new arena in the fairgrounds would complete that facility. It's now become, I'm told by one of my customers, the premier horse show facility in the Northeast once we get that arena built. But there's a drainage problem all through that area. The solution is a 48-inch pipe running underneath the runway of the airport out to the river. It's been all identified. We've got prices on about $5.5 million. The Federal Aviation Commission is willing to chip in. The city just needs to come up with our part to make that happen. And then I believe, I may be mistaken on this, you might know more, I believe there's money available from the state and federal grants to build the arena. If we can just solve the stormwater issue below the arena.
Again,
we don't have a source of money.
The fairgrounds, there's a lot of issues with the fairgrounds. It may not be something that, besides there's a lot of state money for the fairgrounds range, but the Wood Street Brook is the kind of stormwater management that we're talking about.
We've got all of the retaining wall along the Mill River up at the state sanitarium, out past Church Act. It's falling into the river, exposing the sewer pipe coming from Williamsburg. So again, we don't have money for that. And if we did fix it, FEMA has told us, or through MEMA, the Massachusetts Emergency, that they will give us most of the money back if we first fix it. But we need the money to fix it. Hopefully this is going to provide money that we begin chipping away at these all relatively needy projects.
So we're going to wrap things up now, but if you have more questions, please, we'll be here available afterwards.
We'll be here.
I do want to respect everyone's time as a whole since we called it for 7 to 8:30, and I just don't want people to have to feel like they have to walk out. And instead what we can do is close it and then if people have extra questions and want to talk independently, separately, that would be great. And there's also continuing forums, one tomorrow night. So on the website, are they listed on the website? They're listed on the Northampton. I'm sure they are. So I just want to say, my name is Pamela Schwartz, work for City Councilor, and I just want to give a hearty thank you to Terry and to the Department of Public Works staff. By Terry, it's an extraordinary number of hours of commitment, and thank you to those members who are here on the task force for your time and commitment. It really is an extraordinary demonstration of what it takes to make our city great, and thank you for being here. It's a great, your participation. So, onwards.
Thank you.